remind us of the thing that we said in the very beginning about kinematic space, which is that it is the quotient of either SO D comma 2 mod SO D minus 1 comma 1 times SO 1 1 in the Lorentzian case, or in the Euclidean case, it's SO D plus 1 comma 1 mod SO D SO 1 1. So if I want to have an object which acts point-like in kinematic space, the easiest thing that I would do is I would take these objects over here and I would ask, how do they transform? And do they transform under these quotient things, under the things that I'm quotienting over here? If I want to have an object which lives on the quotient, then what I should do is, well, how do we construct any object that is well-defined on a quotient space? Well, if my ingredients do not live on the quotient, one thing that I can do is integrate over this entire group, and the moment I form an integral, the resulting object, the integrated object, will be well-defined on the quotient. That's integrating over this whole group, the orbit of the whole group, by which I am quotienting. So the thing that I should ask right now is, these things that live in the denominator over here, this SOD and this SO1, 1, or this SOD minus 1, 1 and this SO1, 1, how do they act on the right-hand side of this equation? And if they act in some non-trivial way, then I will want to group all things that live in a single multiplet of these representations and put them together, and that will be the object that lives here. Is that logic clear?
Yes.
Notice what interpretation does that have in the bulk of ADS. So if I have an ADS, interpretation, then this SOD thing, if I mod out by it, this is the space of rotations in the directions that are orthogonal to my geodesic. So that's like saying that I'm going to integrate all possible angular directions around my geodesic. Whereas this 1, 1 has the interpretation of going along the geodesic, and I also want to integrate along that. Yes? So from the bulk point of view, right away I know that the objects I will have are going to be integrals along the geodesic, or in fact not necessarily along the geodesics. What they could also be is sort of tubes that go all the way around the geodesic. If you see what I mean? Because any such tubular thing which surrounds the geodesic at a fixed distance is also a good orbit of that symmetry. Yes? So I drew this geodesic in that fashion. This is a little harder to see. But what is a geodesic? It's just a straight line, yes? So if I don't have to worry, if I temporarily don't worry about the properties of ADS space, locally what I have is just a straight line. And these yellow things that I drew here are circles that form together a cylinder that surrounds that line, yes? So these yellow things are supposed to draw for me a cylinder surrounding the line. And the statement that I'm making is that the objects we're looking for are necessarily going to be integrals on such cylindrical slices surrounding the geodesic. And one of those cylindrical slices is the geodesic itself. These are the things that are fixed by that symmetry by which I'm quotienting. Are there any questions about what we've said so far? No questions? Okay, so what do I do? Let's focus on this SO1, 1. And suppose that I take one element of this right-hand side of that expression, yes? What it's going to do for me, if I take one of the generators of this SO1, 1 and apply it to this, is that it will form an operator which looks like d mu O delta of y. So if I started, if this guy was a primary operator, then the action of this SO1, 1 is in general going to produce for me a descendant operator. Is that a logical thing that I could have anticipated? The answer is yes, because what are these descendant operators? These descendant operators are basically pieces of local primary operators which are translated a little bit over. So for example, what I mean by that is that if I have to if I have an O delta of y, and I want to express it about some different center point in the CFD, I can just use the Taylor expansion. And I can say that this is equal to O delta of w plus w minus, or what is it? Y minus w mu d mu O delta of w plus higher order terms. I have just used the Taylor expansion, yes? And so, so the choice of where I put the center obviously is immaterial, but differences between such choices account for descendant operators. This is a descendant. So in some way, I can think of descendant operators as being differences between different choices of center points in which I, around which I express my operators, yes? So what do I do when I use this SO1, 1? When I use this SO1, 1, in the bulk, I'm going all the way along the geodesic. What am I doing in the CFT? In the CFT, I'm also going from the point Y to the point X, yes? So if I want to integrate over all these points, yes, going from one term to the other term, I'm integrating a bunch of objects, each of which are translated to each other, correct? And those translates are going to differ from one another by descendant operators. So just that alone guarantees for me that the action of this SO1, 1 has to include some descendant operators which are part of this expression. And the action of SO1, 1 is going to include for me, or automatically isolate for me, a bunch of these descendants. So, like many of them. So a way that I can proceed to define an object that lives in kinematic space is to rewrite this expression one more time. Let me just rewrite it one more time. O1 of x, O2 of y. So bear with me while I copy my formula. I have C1, 2 delta. And over here, I'm going to have again my O delta of y, but I'm going to, as we were describing just now, as I was motivating just now, I'm going to group all the terms on the right-hand side here, which are descendants of a common operator, which is what this SO1, 1 is asking me to do if I want to if I want to integrate over its orbit. So over here in this parenthesis that I left for myself, I'm going to include a 1. The 1 picks out just this primary operator, if it happened to be a primary. But then I also want to include the descendants of that same primary. This sum was ranging over all possible operators. So I will also take x minus y to the mu d mu. Yes? And this thing will come with some prefactor, and that prefactor is kinematically fixed, and we will never have to worry about what it is explicitly. It's just some number that depends on x and y. And I will also have terms. This is a little, I'm gonna erase it and put it over here so that it's a little clearer to see. Is that, do I have an okay for that from you? So I'll have an O delta of y. And on that O delta, I have a 1 acting, I have an x minus y mu d mu with some prefactor, which I will not write down explicitly. I will also have further descendants, which look like x minus y mu d mu d mu, and so on. And the point is that I'm grouping all of these objects together, and these objects together are are a good candidate for what could be associated with a single point that lives over here. Because in forming this sum, I have integrated over the orbit of the SO1, which sits in the denominator. Are there any questions about that?
Yes. When you have a finite number of descendants, for what reason the higher order derivatives vanish?
Oh, why did you say that I have a finite?
No. In this case, it's a general case in which you can have like, infinite expansion.
Yeah.
But there are some CFTs in which you have a finite number of descendants.
finite number of like of conformal symmetric descendants?
Yes.
So you're talking about some kind of short multiplets of the of conformal symmetry? So that would be like saying that I have an L minus 1 to some power of n, and for some reason this thing equals to 0 for some n?
Yes.
Okay. So I don't know about that. But the so I don't know about that. If that happens in some theories, which I don't know, and I mean, I'm not an expert on CFTs, so maybe there's some theory that does that and I just have never heard of it. But it wouldn't have a nice ADS interpretation, because over here, the fact that I have infinitely many descendants corresponds to the fact that the orbit of this SO1, 1 is non-compact, which corresponds to the fact that the geodesic is infinite. So I suppose what I could do maybe is to take this geodesic and further quotient this by some periodic distance. So I'm essentially making this this object periodic. I mean, I probably could quotient by that. And if I do this, then I guess I would have a condition of this type. That would just be the statement that, well, yeah, the periodicity statement. In some sense, that's what we do when we go to the thermal state in CFT2, because the thermal state in CFT2 is given by taking a quotient of, I mean, in this geometric language, I'm basically taking a quotient of this geometry. So this corresponds to breaking conformal symmetry by a temperature. So I have trouble imagining how this would be true without breaking conformal symmetry, because that's exactly what happens when we do break symmetry with temperature. So the point is that I don't know if that happens, but if it does, I know that how it happens in the case of a thermal state, then we broken conformal symmetry. And if it happens in some other situation, then we would be drastically departing from this ADS picture. In fact, the thermal example is sort of that, where we depart from the ADS picture and get instead an ADS black hole.
I also haven't heard about the superconformalism.
Yes.
Rather than descendants with momentum.
Yes, you have to consider supergroup.
Oh, okay. Well, but then, so that's, so yeah, so there's, so this group, so we're, instead of taking S of D plus 1, 1, we would have S of D plus 1, 1. With some fermionic component, which we denote like that. And then this fermionic component is generators of it are, what is it called, idempotent. Some power of them becomes zero. So yes, in that case, that's true. Notice that this is not realized geometrically in ADS, although there is an exception to that. But generally speaking, this will not be geometrically realized. Except maybe, I shouldn't say that. There are some ways to realize that geometrically too, but this goes outside the scope of what we're talking about here. So in the Grassmannian language of computing amplitudes, we do that. And also in how dual conformal invariance was discovered and the Yang-Yang symmetry of n equals 4 superangles, they were essentially taking something like a fermionic T-duality. And so they were geometrizing those directions. But anyway, we won't be talking about that, and I don't know much about it. So here we are, and I want to say that this object over here, including the power of x minus y to the delta, okay, this thing I'm going to use a different color chalk to box it. This thing is what we will call an OPE block, and I will use a notation d sub delta of x comma y for it. And the statement is that by writing down this formula, we have constructed an object which has a point-like behavior in kinematic space. So that's what we wanted. These are the operators that live in kinematic space. And remember, from the bulk point of view, these are things that are naturally associated with objects that are integrated over the orbits of that symmetry, which basically means that they live on tubular or sort of cylindrical shells surrounding that geodesic that connects x and y.
I think in the bulk you described that you could have these tubes or you could have the tube to a geodesic itself.
Yes.
In the boundaries using the CFT, when you're looking at these two operators, you spoke about these translated versions, which implement the S of 1, 1.
Uh-huh.
But the other piece, somehow, I guess, we're basically in the collapse tube case. what you're describing now, yes? And then somehow, this SOB plus 1, comma 1 is the thing that it is fixed precisely those two points?
Say again, are you talking about this part of the quotient?
Same direction, please. Well, it doesn't matter.
Okay, sure. This part, yeah.
Yeah.
In this case, these things are not going to be tubes in that sense. What they're going to be are, I drew them as tubes because I was assuming SOD symmetry is surrounding my line. But what happens if I have SOD minus 1, comma 1 in the Lorentzian case? That means that I want to, it's like I have circles, but they are Lorentzian circles. What are Lorentzian circles? They're hyperbola. And so instead of having a picture like this, I'm going to have a picture. It was a little unfortunate that I drew it vertically because this is actually a space like curve. So let me redraw it and then I'll draw the other thing. So for the space like case, we're talking about a geodesic which possibly is surrounded by a cylindrical sort of tube. Whereas in the Lorentzian case, what I would have is our hyperbolae that are constant Lorentzian distance away from that geodesic. So if I have a geodesic going this way, these would be slices of that type. And if you're the kind of person who likes drawing pictures in ABS, we can give names for these things. So let me draw back again my geodesic realistically as part of the ABS cylinder. So here is an ABS cylinder, and here is a geodesic that I drew here. So the endpoints of that geodesic fix for me some causal diamond. And then what I have what are slices that live at a constant distance from this geodesic? They would look like this on a spatial slice, and then they would sort of go higher and higher and form a picture of this type. What these things are in so-called ABS Rindler slicing. These are radial slices in ABS Rindler space. And for some of you, this will not have any explanatory power, what I just said. But for those of you who have thought about ABS Rindler, then that's what they are. They are radial slices in ABS Rindler. But basically, these are loci that are a common distance from a given geodesic. That's what it is. There'll be two other branches, absolutely. There will also be branches of this type, which will asymptote to this other causal diamond that this guy defines. Absolutely. So these things, I drew them as two branches. There are actually two branches only in ADS-free, because in ADS-free, we're in this case, D equals 2. So I have another SO1, comma 1, which is just another line. So I just have a line times a line. But in higher dimensions, this will be SO2, comma 1. That's a connected group, so that I will be able to rotate my way from here to there. It's only in ADS-free that there are actually two branches. Any other comments or questions? These are excellent questions, which mean that we're on the same page, so I'm very happy about that.
I don't understand how you drew the second branch. I would have thought you meant the complementary Rindler branch?
The complementary Rindler branch.
Okay, so
yeah.
So then you have words for
them. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So, so now, yes. Good. We've already gone over this. There's something that, depending on how familiar you are with the CFT, you may or may not want to protest against. So here is why you might want to protest. When I wrote this formula, I had this OP coefficient, which was the coefficient for merging an operator O1 and O2 and fusing it onto this operator O delta. And I had a sum here which ranged over all possible operators. So now that I've grouped some of these operators together, am I still allowed to have this coefficient here in front? I would not be allowed to do so if one of these primaries, the one which comes from 1 times this, and the descendant, which comes from d mu times that, actually had different OP coefficients. In this formula, they looked like they had different coefficients. So is everyone familiar with the statement that OP coefficients are the same for primaries and for descendants? So, and that's just a fact. And one way that we can see that that must be true is basically this point. Because when we use the OPE expansion, I have the freedom of expressing the right-hand side anywhere between x and y. So here I chose the y quantization, but I could have expressed the same thing about x, or I could have expressed the same thing about any point, yes? And so I have these many different forms that the right-hand side can take, and they all differ by Taylor expansions of the right-hand side, yes? But eventually they have to give me the same formulas. If descendants and primaries have different OP coefficients, then going from one point of about which I'm writing the right-hand side to another would detect that, because the difference in the OP coefficients of descendants would kick in the moment I attempted to use this formula. Does that make sense? And so OP coefficients have to be the same for whole conformal families. A more highbrow way of saying this is that if I have some operator which inserts the representation O1, and I have some other operator which inserts representation O2, then if I make a cut over here, then this cut chooses for me some state in that representation of conformal group. And if I make a cut over here, I'm choosing some state in the representation of that conformal group. And those states are primaries and descendants within the same, created by the same operator. So if I now surround this thing by a larger circle, that's what it means to use the OPE. I'm forgetting about the fact that I've inserted two things. I'm just asking about what state lives on the total slice that surrounds them. It would be very strange if I had different OPE coefficients in different states that belong to the same representation. That would be like saying that in the spin language, that would be like saying that the z eigenvector of the spin and z eigenvector of the spin combined to some other multiplicity of in the combined spin representation, but the x and the x component don't. That would be very strange. So anyway, from the viewpoint of representation theory, it is necessary that this guy has to have the same values for primaries and descendants. So I'm allowed to do this. Now, okay, so in the end, we have rewritten our operator product expansion in the language that I will try to press harder here. O1x O2y is equal to x minus y minus delta 1 minus delta 2 times the sum over primaries only now of C1 to delta, x minus y to the delta, and the OTD block, OXY delta. And this is a big simplification over here, because instead of summing over all operators, I only sum over primaries. And these guys there live on kinematic space. That's just a repetition of what I said before. So what other facts or what other things can we say about these OPE block operators? Well, one thing I can say, do they satisfy some specific equation? Well, one thing I can say is that in a CFT, representations of the conformal group are classified by their, at least partially classified, by their eigenvalue under the Casimir operator. Casimir eigenvalue. So, in the context of the Lorentz group, this is the statement that we have p squared equals m squared. That p squared here is the Casimir of the Lorentz group, and it, when you act on it with it on some representation, which is some particle in your theory, you'll get a number, and that number we interpret, or we call it mass squared. So different masses or different representations are different eigenvalues of the Casimir. So in the conformal theory, we have the same or an analogous statement. So The Casimir operator, if I write it down explicitly, for a 2D CFD, and I should say that when I say for 2D CFD, I will be only using global conformal symmetry, so I'm not doing Virazora at all, only global. Then this Casimir operator takes the form L0 squared plus 1 half of L1 L minus 1 plus L minus 1 L1. And since I have left movers and right movers, I will have the same thing for the bar generator. So this is my Casimir. And in higher dimensional cases, I won't write them explicitly, but one thing that we can say is that notice that our symmetry group is, let's say in the Euclidean case, that's a little easier to say, is SOD plus 1, 1. Suppose that we were talking about SOD plus 2, then what would we say then? Then we would say that these we're looking for the Casimir of just the rotation group. And what would that be? It would be like adding up the angular, writing down the angular momentum squared operator in this many dimensions, in the corresponding number of dimensions. So all I would have to do is take a generator for every representation, square it, and add them all together. So now, instead of having SFD plus 1, 1, I will have some generators which are non-compact, but the procedure is the same. All I'm doing is essentially computing the total angular momentum in this mixed signature coordinate, and that's what the Casimir is. And it takes some form which I will not be writing down over here. So these things I will call L squared. L squared is the Casimir. I wrote it as L squared. You might think of this as J squared being angular momentum squared if this had been SOD plus 2. So the statement that I want to make is that L squared, when it acts on our OPE block, is going to give us a specific eigenvalue, which is, I might as well say, I pretended so far that our OPE block was a scalar, so there, I didn't write an L, a spin quantum number, but let me just reinsert it over there. So the formula that I will have on the right-hand side is minus delta minus D minus L times L plus D minus 2. And this is my eigenvalue of that under that equation. Now, why is this equation true? The statement is that we know that this equation is true from reading conformal field theory textbooks when I act with it on any one operator in this representation. So for example, when I act with it on the primary operator, so just this O delta, this equation would be satisfied with O delta. How about if I act with that same operator on the left-hand side, and with the Casimir, on the d mu times my operator? Well, that's another operator in the same representation, yes? But I just told you that this object characterizes the entire representation. So it will give me the same eigenvalue on the descendant, and on the next descendant, and on all the terms that live over here. That means that the entire object is also an eigenvector of that operator. And so that's why this equation holds. Any questions about that? I have an observation to make here. So, nota bene. If L is equal to 0, then this equation becomes essentially, okay, then this object over here that I have is just minus n squared for the corresponding representation and for the corresponding field in ADS. Yes. And so if this is true, then I can just write this equation as L squared d delta L of x comma y. So let me write L squared equals minus n squared, so L squared plus n squared d delta L x comma y equals to 0. So that will be where m squared is the ADS mass of the corresponding field. So that's going to be an interesting or an important equation for us a little later. In fact, let me say why this is interesting. It's interesting because this Casimir here has a, whenever, this is a fact that I just have to pull out of a hat, although it's not hard to see or prove. The statement is that if I act with the Casimir on a homogeneous group, which is a quotient of some group, then the Casimir acts as the wave operator, as the D'Alembertian or the box operator. So in fact, L squared is the box for any in any space which is a homogeneous space with that symmetry group. So in particular, this means that when I act with L squared on objects that live, so for example, when I act with L squared objects which live in ADS, remember ADS is SOD comma 2 mod SOD comma 1, so it also is a homogeneous space. Then L squared is the box acting on ADS. Or if I act with L squared on operators which live in kinematic space, which is also a quotient of this, then L squared is going to act like the wave operator in kinematic space. If I didn't tell you yesterday about how to write down the metric for the wave equation, this would be for kinematic space, this would be a confusing statement. But we already know that it has a metric. This metric defines for us some wave operator, and the statement I'm making right now is that this L squared is in fact the wave operator in kinematic space. And I won't prove it for you, but there is an easy general proof that you can look up. We refer to it in our paper, for example, which just establishes that it's not worth it to try to prove it specifically for a kinematic space. The point is that it works for any completely homogeneous space. And roughly speaking, the proof is that if you have it's like when you do compactification. When you suppose that you have a wave equation which is solved in 10 dimensions, but some of those dimensions are compact. You're going to compactify on those dimensions. So then the wave operator becomes the wave operator on the smaller space after compactification, up to extra things which have to do with the wave numbers along the compact dimensions. But in here, we integrated over the compact dimensions. So we're talking about the zero mode along these directions. And that means that there won't be any additional thing that will be coming from the modes in that dimension. This is like a compactification by SO1, 1, which is not the right word to say, because SO1, 1 is not compact, but it's a dimensional reduction. So we have this equation. Now you might say that the moment that I have this equation, which looks like, so these are objects that live in kinematic space. So using this fact, what I should say really is that the wave equation, the wave operator in kinematic space, plus m squared acting on d delta l, or just d delta l x y, is equal to zero. So we have an equation of this type. You might say, can I just go ahead and solve this equation and thereby explicitly tell you what these OP blocks are? I mean, I have a definition of them in terms of the CFT, but is there a sense in which I can take this equation and solve it? So there is a caveat to this, which is that, remember, our kinematic space has d time dimensions. This is just one equation. So for a solution, so to solve this, I would need another d plus 1, d minus 1 equations. That's statement number 1. And another statement that I want to say is that, okay, so we're going to come back to this point a little later. And then the other thing that I wanted to point out, that will be my remark too, is that now that I wrote this, and I made these statements about the Casimir acting as a wave operator, you might say, oh, okay, my d deltas are supposed to be these objects in ADS which are smeared along cylindrical tubes in ADS space. And what objects would they be? Well, my b carries wave carries quantum numbers which characterize a particular representation of conformal group. Any such representation will correspond to a particle that can live in ADS space. So there is always an operator in the bulk of ADS which carries these same quantum numbers, like phi delta. So you could say, just what kind, and I know that this guy has to be built by smearing something along these cylindrical tubes. So what could I be smearing? I have to be smearing somehow these phi delta. I mean, there's no other candidate for what I might be smearing to observe, to obtain these b deltas. Now this phi here, so we have a couple of things that we have to do. One of them is to verify that indeed smearing this phi along these tubular loci will produce for me the b delta. That's one thing that we will have to do in the remainder of our meeting today. Another thing that we have to do, maybe that's an easier one, is to say, what equation does this phi delta satisfy? This phi delta satisfies an equation which is the ADS wave operator minus n squared now, acting on phi, is equal to zero. This equation is similar to this one, but different. So you could say, is there a relation between this one and that one, or in what way do they, yeah, why is it that somehow one of them must translate into the other, so why and how? Our plan for the rest of the talk clear? We have to verify that indeed smearing this ADS operator along these objects is going to produce for me the B delta, and also we have to understand how these equations relate to one another. These are the two things we have to do. There's actually there's a third thing to do. We have to come back to this issue of extra d minus one equations. It would be nice to understand what to do with the extra equations. Okay, any questions at this point? So since I started talking about solving these wave equations, one thing that I would have to do to solve this equation is, in addition to providing the remaining d minus one equations that are also necessary, is I would have to have an initial condition. So what would be what initial condition would I have to take? So let's think about that. Oh, I have this right here, so maybe let me not erase it. So, initial condition. Remember, what lived at the very bottom of kinematic space, we talked about this yesterday, were intervals, or pairs of points, which are coincident, or intervals of zero size. So the very bottom, the sort of infinite past of kinematic space, is where the two points are sitting right on top of each other. So what I should be doing for identifying an initial condition is to take the limit when x goes to y of just this expression. So what's going to happen when I take x to y in this expression? Well, all these other terms have an extra power of x minus y, yes? So they will be subleading relative to this one which sits over here. So the statement is that this thing is subleading, this thing is subleading, and everything else is subleading, except for the piece which comes from the one. And so the limit of my OP block is really just x minus y to the delta times O delta of y. Yes? Is everyone okay with that statement? If I think of x minus y as a
Have a limit on the right, or because you say limit x goes to y?
Yeah, I have the limit of the right. You want me to say zero here?
No.
Oh, okay. So to make it the proper way to write it would be to say this divided by x minus y to the delta would give us the operator. And this is, I know that this is sloppy notation. I'm just emphasizing in what way this goes to zero. So So one thing that I want to remind you of is our definition of a boundary operator in terms of about field. Yes? Yes.
You mentioned that eventually you will find a relation between those two equations. Right?
Yes.
What happens if you think instead of considering a scalar field,
I haven't prepared for this talk anything about spin fields, just because they're more complicated to describe. But this story has been worked out in detail in a paper that came out maybe 2 weeks ago. So in the paper that I was a co-author of, we stopped here for scalar fields, and we just said, we were sure whether it will work for spinning fields. So this spinning field story has been completed in a paper that came out 2 weeks ago by Andreas Karsch and James Sully. By Ethan Dyer and Dan Friedman and James Sully from 2 weeks ago. So all of these equations will be modified because the relation between m squared and this will be different, and there will be some extra spinning terms. But the story is essentially the same, and I refer you to that paper for any details. So I wanted to, over here, I wanted to remind you of how we defined 2 days ago a local operator in the CFP. So in the CFP, we said last time that O delta at some point y is really the limit as z goes to zero of z to the minus delta times some phi in ADS, which lives at that same y and z. Is that the correct formula that we wrote before? So looking at this formula and comparing with this formula over here, I see that this thing is nothing but phi ADS at the same point y and z equaling to x minus y. Is that correct? Good. So first of all, we have our initial condition. And the second thing is that this goes long ways into supporting the idea that the objects we're building are actually integrals of these fields in ADS. Because if I take the limit as x goes to y, the whole geodesic becomes a point. I mean, collapses to a point. There's no point to integrate along a geodesic. It's just a point. At what point is that phi going to be evaluated? At just this point. And if you want to take this limit a little more seriously, you would say, why is it that z equals x minus y? Well, if x and y are very small, then I'm not going very, the geodesic over here is not going very far. It seems like the LPE block to leading order approximation collapses to the point which lives just at the top of this, at the tip of this geodesic, at the deepest point over there. And why is it that point? Because that's the point where z is equal to x minus y. That's the point where my geodesic is deepest in, and that's where this thing happens to be. Where this is what this initial condition happens to pick out for me. Now you might say, why is this point and not some other point picked out? But of course, notice that we're taking a limit where z is going to zero, or x minus y is going to zero. But remember, we talked about this on Tuesday, that taking the limit as z goes to zero always breaks conformal symmetry, because it depends how we take that limit. So if I took that limit not in this way, but first I would apply some special conformal transformation, so I would rotate my z equals constant slices and then push to the boundary, then instead of this point, I would select that point or some other point. So the point is that depending on regularization scheme I'm working with, or how I chose to break conformal invariance, in particular special conformal invariance, special conformal symmetries, I will get my phi ADS at various points, and the differences between those various things that I could obtain are, what are they? They are those subleading things which I crossed over here. These are the differences between the various regularization schemes or various ways of approaching the boundary account for those are subleading, and they account for those terms which I dropped out in selecting this initial condition, and they correspond to descendants. Yes?
For a given regularization, does it matter the order in which you take the limits in order to define the initial condition in terms of the fields in ADS?
But I only took one limit, so what
you're but then you have to relate the field in ADS to operators, local operators in the field theory. And then you take a limit that is the radial coordinate.
You mean that this guy itself is also a limit? So
yes, in terms of the fields in ADS.
Yeah, so those two limits sort of cancel each other out, is what I'm trying to say. I guess there's a limit on both sides of the equation, and I say if the limits agree, then up to subleading corrections, the expressions agree themselves. That's the statement I make.
I see.
So, of course, this is not something we can do. We can't just cross the limit sign on both sides of an equation. But we can if we only care about leading order terms. And that's what I said. This is the leading order answer, and there are subleading expressions, and those subleading expressions correspond to differences between the different ways in which I approach the boundary, so they differ by the action of special conformal symmetries. I left this so that I could erase this now, and this board is going to become for us a table where we summarize all the facts that we already know, and make a list of things that we want to know or prove that we haven't shown yet. So the table is going to look like this. I will have kinematic space on one side and ABS on the other side. You might say, why don't I have a third column, which is the CFD? Yeah, because we really have ABS and CFD and the kinematic space, which is like a bridge between both. But there's nothing we need to say anymore about the CFD, because we already proved, I gave you an expression for what OPE blocks are. So we have an explicit definition in the CFD. And there's nothing more to say about the CFD, really. But ADS and kinematic space. So in kinematic space, I have this formula. I'm just going to copy that formula over there, which is del squared kinematic space, del squared in kinematic space plus m squared b delta of x, y equals 0. And that's the first equation of motion. Then I will have the equations of motion from 2 to d. So this is not 2d, this is 2, 3, and so on until d. These are the remaining d minus 1 equations. We still don't know what they are, so I'll put question marks here. We will fill them in. And then I have the initial conditions. Initial conditions. And the initial condition is, I don't really need to separate this over here, is the statement that I made over here, which is that the limit as x goes to y of b delta of x comma y, that's a limit in kinematic space, is in fact an ADS field which lives at y and z, which is the difference of x minus y. Okay, so we have the initial condition, we have this equation of motion, and we know that the counterpart I have over here is the ABS equation of motion, which is this one. And the question is, so what question marks do we have? First of all, how do these equations talk to one another, is one question. The second question is, what are these guys? What are these extra equations? But before I talk about either of those things, I actually want to accomplish one other goal, which is, I've been talking about these tubes and so on. I want to convince you that, in fact, the tubes or the cylindrical regions of integration are completely useless, and I might as well just integrate along the geodesic. So that's not really unstable, but that will be a big simplification. So far, I had argued for you, based on symmetries alone, that what this d delta has to be is an integral either along a geodesic or an integral along these cylindrical tubes surrounding a geodesic. And now I want to convince you that, in fact, these cylindrical tubes are unnecessary, and I just It's enough for me to integrate along geodesics. And after that, we will get back to these questions. Are there any questions about the plan or about what we have said so far? No, so I'm going to keep going. So, we're now going to do a calculation, which is not in my paper, but which is pretty, I hope is pretty illuminating. In general, I'm presenting this material in a very different way from how it's written in the paper. The paper is mostly aimed at making sure that no one can challenge what we're saying. It just contains proofs. Whereas here, I'm trying to develop things so that you could imagine how you could have arrived at the same conclusion just by thinking about it. And for the most part, notice that the logic that we are going through didn't require almost any calculations. All I had to say is, well, these symmetries look like they correspond to tubular regions in the ADS. I'll have to integrate along tubes. I didn't actually have to do the integral. It's just thinking about what the symmetries tell me that is the guide to the answer. So in a similar fashion, let's try to argue our way to deciding that we don't have to integrate over these tubular networks. So to do this, I want to compute a three-point function of my O1 of x, O2 of y, and some other O delta of w, okay? In various ways, and we will equal those various expressions. So one thing to say, just using the definition of the OPE block, is that, remember, O1 and O2 together have this expansion in terms of OPE blocks. It was there that I erased it, but it's the statement that O1x, O2y is equal to x minus 1 to this expression times the sum over OPE blocks times the OPE block. Okay? So this was the expression for this product. So I'm going to use this here on these first two operators. But of course, after that, I will be taking so this expression combines the first two operators to single operators. And then I'll be taking an expectation value of that with some other O delta. So all conformal representations which are not delta are going to drop out from this because the two-point function is, I would say, diagonal in representations. Only fields in the same representation will have a non-dimensional two-point function. So I might as well replace this thing with only that one term that I have here, which corresponds to my dimension delta, which is this one. So what I will write here is x minus y to the delta 1, delta 2. Okay, that's the prefactor that I have over here. I will have my OPE coefficient, which is this. And after that, I have my b delta. So I have b delta of x comma y times o delta of w. Okay? Mm-hmm.
I suppose if you have some degeneracy, you could have a division problem operator the same.
Yeah, there will be some other operator which takes symmetric and anti-symmetric combinations of operators with the same delta. So like that completes the set of commuting, the full set of commuting observables. And then I would have another quantum number here which would distinguish them. So, yeah. And I would have some orthogonality in that extra quantum number as well. So like spin does that for you. Like if we had spinning fields, then I would have to do that. Okay, so I have this, and for these formulas, I would like to write down the corresponding Witten diagrams, which is what we did on Tuesday, if you remember. So over here, I'll have a picture where I have some x and some y and some w. And I am drawing propagators together that meet over here. And what this, and I'm supposed to integrate over this, I'm going to call this point y, where the free propagators meet. And the Witten diagram prescription for this three-point function is to say that I have some coupling constant, which I will call g. And then after that, I integrate over the whole ABS space, which is the d plus one dimensional ABS space. Let me call it dy. And I have these bulk to boundary propagators, which take me from x to my bulk point y, from y to my bulk point y, and from w to my bulk point y. Can everyone see what I wrote here? But that's the expression that we wrote on Tuesday. Yeah. And these things have some conformal dimensions. So this is delta 1, because it's coming from x. This is delta 2, because it's coming from y. And this is just delta, because it's coming from w. Good. So on the other hand, in this expression, I have something similar, which is that if I were to write to draw what this expression is, well, the w plays the same role as before, but my x and y have been collapsed, so I'm no longer writing diagrams of this type, because we all agreed that my OPE block will have a representation in terms of the field, that field delta, I mean the field which corresponds to O delta in the bulk of ABS, integrated either along a geodesic from x to y, or along these tubes. Let me use color for the tubes so we know what we're talking about. This is the color. And I'm using here a static projection, but if I had a time direction as well, there would be some directions that go out in the out of the board. I mean, there would be a time direction out of the board. But a drawing including time would be completely unreadable. So let me just project onto an equal time slice of ABS. So these other things will look like this. That's one of them. Just like Chrisomani said, in our projection, there will actually be a pair of them. Then I will have some other one, which looks like this, okay? And they are all a constant distance from the geodesic, because that's how we define them, okay? And somehow, what I'm supposed to do is to take so what is this doing? This d delta is really a smeared form of a bulk field, yes? And that bulk field, if I write this as a smeared bulk field, then that bulk field, I'm taking a correlation function of that bulk field with O delta, which lives on the boundary, correct? So that's like drawing a propagator from W to one of these points that live over here, yes? And I have to integrate over, first of all these slices, and second of all, over all the tubes, yes? That's really the same integral that I have over here, because by the time I'm done integrating over everything, I'm going to cover all of ABS space, so I'll be back to the same formula. Does that make sense? Is everyone with me on that point? So I just took my ABS, integral over ABS space, and I wrote it in coordinates which respect that SO1, 1 symmetry that I have been emphasizing, and so I sliced my integral in that fashion. So let me do that explicitly. If I do this explicitly, this is the same expression that I'm writing here, so let me write an equal sign. I will still have a bulk coupling constant over here, but my integral that I have over there, I'm going to write it as in two steps. First of all, I will have an integral d cube, or d cylinder, so I'm integrating over colors in this drawing, or over different radial slices. And then on every tube, I will be integrating ds, which is the length along a geodesic. Or for these other tubes, I will have a higher dimensional integral. I basically have to integrate over the cylinder. So maybe I should say d cylinder over here. Or a cube. Is it okay if I call them cubes? Is it clear what I mean? Okay. So I have this. And so I just rewrote this measure or this integral, and I will still write the same bulk to boundary propagators, which is from x to, well, we know where they're going. They're going from here to the point selected by these integrals. So let me not write their coordinates. I will just write delta 1, delta 2, and delta for the third one, which I drew explicitly for you over here. Good. So what I want to do now is to pick out a piece of this formula which really, how to say this? Give me a second so I find the best way to say it. That third one I'm going to write explicitly.
I would have thought you would have write just one propagator to the board point on the domestic, and that would be it.
Well, it depends by what I mean by this guy. So I could do this introducing the bulk field, but this is still in terms of this is all bulk to boundary propagators. So I just rewrote this expression in a way which respects this thing, but I still don't know about the bulk field. I still haven't used the expression in terms of the bulk field. So yeah, I could do that, but that's kind of where we want to go with this. So I haven't put it in by hand yet. So as a next step, I want to say that this expression, I'm going to erase the board now. Is equal to g times integral d cube and I want to think about just this part of the expression, which is what Alberto was really pointing out over here, which is, let's think about what these bulk operators over here are really doing. What they're doing is, what they're telling me, that some operator over here has created a disturbance, and some operator over there has created a disturbance. And what these operators are doing at any given point on the tube and on S, yes, are computing the disturbance of the bulk field dual to this, which is created by the action of those two operators. So in fact, I could reorganize this expression as an expression which is, for each one of them, I am really computing the expectation value of the operator L delta evaluated at W. But expectation value in what? Expectation value in a bulk field set up by O delta O1x and O2y. Does that make sense? At the point on this tube. And in fact, I have an integral of the, yes, okay, that's what I meant. And the way I wrote this over here is that I am taking an integral over all possible tubes, so that I have, I mean, the full expression asks me to integrate over the whole thing. But I organized it into a specific tube by tube, such that any one of these expressions looks like this. I had some x and I had some y. I had some operators which were acting. And now I'm saying, suppose that somehow these operators have only created a disturbance on a particular tube, which is, for example, the red one from this drawing. What is the value of the field at this point if I have acted with these two things? It's the product of this bulk-to-boundary propagator and this bulk-to-boundary propagator. This is what tells me how much of a field I have over here, given the disturbances there and there. Yes. And then I have integrated that along my tube. And for any one such tube, I say, what's the expectation value of this operator in that bulk in this bulk configuration. Now I'm going to take that bulk configuration and add to it the other bulk configuration, another one, and integrate over all of them together. Evidently, this is not how we usually think about computing correlation functions. Usually, what we think of is that I will compute a correlation function given that there is some bulk configuration. I have to know the entire field configuration ahead of time, and then I just integrate over the whole field. But in fact, the problem is linear. So I can first imagine that my operator set up something just on this tube, and then on some other tube, and then on some other tube. All together, if I do it collectively and integrate over that, this will be the entire field configuration in ADS space. And then given that, I will compute my correlation function. Does that make sense? Okay, so this is the expression that I wanted to have, and any one of these things corresponds to the expectation value of this operator inserted at W, given a disturbance which is localized on the tube, which was produced by these two things. Notice that the way that I wrote it over here, this expression, this expectation value, is really evaluated by integrating over the tube, and so this guy here is going to be given by integrating over the internal coordinates of the tube, O delta of W times the bulk ADS field created by these other disturbances. That's really what I have done. That's what this expectation value here means. And this guy over here is the bulk to boundary operator from W to my point on the tube, which is what I had over there. So this is how these expressions correspond. But if I think about what form this expression takes, we can tell a story about it. And the story is this. Suppose that we're talking about electromagnetism, and there was some charge configuration that was sitting over here. Then this propagator here, integrating it, a propagator from here to everywhere on this tube, integrating this over the volume of the tube, would compute for me the electrostatic energy of that field configuration, or in other words, the electrostatic energy of putting that charge over here, given that I already have a charge, uniform charge distribution on the tube. That's what this thing would be doing, correct? But if that's the story I'm telling, then I might as well use Gauss's law, which is that if I have a spherical configuration, I can forget that it's a spherical configuration, just think about the point which sits in the center. Here we don't quite have a spherical configuration. Instead, we have a configuration which is cylindrical. But I still have the same Gauss's law type symmetry argument, which says that if I'm going to compute this expression evaluated for some tube, then up to a numerical prefactor, this is going to be the same thing as that same expression evaluated just for the geodesic, yes? And so up to a proportionality constant, so this is just proportional, yes? This is in fact equal to g times the expectation value of O delta times just the central tube, which is the center of the cylindrical coordinates, which is the integral of pi ads along the geodesic. Does that make sense?
Why is it just the proportionality, not the quality?
Oh, because I have to integrate over every tube. So I have one tube and another and another. I have to integrate over all the cylinders. And it wasn't obvious that they were giving me exactly the same number, because I still had these propagators, which were setting up some charge configuration over here. How much charge I have on the cylinder depends on these guys. And I didn't give you a reason for why the amount that I would have to have on these guys would have to be the same on all of them. So there's just some proportionality, but the proportionality is definitely there. Also, I am actually integrating, I'm adding them all up, so I'm not just taking the average over them, then I would have inequality, I'm adding them all up. So there's some proportionality. But it's okay, everything here we're doing here is up to a constant numerical factor, because I have a bulk coupling constant g, and at the end of the day, what I should actually get is the OPE coefficient. So I'm always trading, everything is up to a multiplicative constant anyway, so who cares? The important expression is the dependence on the insertion point here and of the endpoints of the geodesic, and that's the same as this. So, so this is the reason for why, in fact, my OPE blocks have this very nice expression, which is, so to this expression over here, I guess, which is the initial condition, now I can see that this initial condition was in fact necessitated in yet another way, which is, let me just write down without the limit what the OPE block has to be, which is B delta X Y is an integral along the geodesic from X to Y of the corresponding bulk field evaluated at S. And I always have some numerical constant in front. So that's what this was. And this initial condition is really just taking out the limit as x goes to y. So when x goes to y, my whole geodesic just collapses to that one point, which is the point that I got over here. Any questions about that? Okay. So in fact, I sort of lied to you about something, so I have to fix this a little bit. This expression is in fact only true when the two operators that I'm starting with, which is delta 1 and delta 2, they have these two different, in general, different conformal dimensions. If they are the same, then this is the expression I want. But if they are different, then in fact I have swept something under the rug in this formula, and let me just explain this now. So everything I said so far relied on somehow absorbing the effect. So from the integral ds of this thing here, we got this expectation value here, which was directly related to the expectation to this two-point function over there. But this requires, we have to think a little bit about the charge distribution that I actually get on my cubes. Yes? So far I said as if this was totally a constant. But in fact, it's not going to be a constant if these conformal dimensions are different. And one way that I can tell that this is not going to be constant is this. Remember, I told you that there is a nice way of thinking about these Feynman diagrams where we're just going to draw geodesics, yes? And every one of these geodesics is like a line which you're pulling with some tension. And the tension is related to delta, or in the semi-classical approximation, to the mass of the field which is propagating along that geodesic. So if x and y, if the operators inserted there, have different conformal dimensions, then x is pulling with a different force than y. Well, if it's pulling with a different force than y, then the meeting point of these three geodesics is always going to be closer to x than to y. Does that make sense? Because x is pulling harder. Or on average, it's going to fall closer there. So somehow, we, in assuming that this charge distribution was going to be completely even, we were really assuming that these conformal dimensions were the same. So let's go ahead and fix it right now. So I haven't done this explicitly in preparing these notes, but let's just think about these operators, what these guys are doing. They are the ones that are setting up this charge distribution. And in the semi-classical approximation, what they are is x minus my bulk point y to the power minus delta 1. And over here I have y minus this guy to the power of minus delta 2. Yes? Let's think about what happens when y sits on the geodesic from x to y. Then what I have is the distance from x to y, and then the distance from y to the boundary y. So altogether, I have had a distance which goes all the way from x to y. This is just x minus y to the power of what? If they are the same dimensions, then I would just have x minus y to the power of delta, which is exactly the expression that I have over here. So these two guys are going to precisely cancel out this x minus y over here, which I have over there. So they'll just account for it. I may have dropped a factor of 2 somehow, so I apologize for it, but let me just keep going. So if the two conformal dimensions are the same, this thing is just going to account for that thing. But if the conformal dimensions are different, then what's going to happen? Then some pieces of my cube are going to be exponentially suppressed relative to the other one, because I have a tension which is pulling me stronger this way than that way. If I take this expression and divide that expression, what I will have is a charge distribution which goes, which varies as I go from x to y, and drops exponentially with an exponent which is the difference of these two conformal dimensions. So I guess what I'm saying is that if you take this expression and divide it by that expression, you will get something which looks like e to the s minus s zero to the power of delta one minus delta two. So I take, I have the exponent, which is the difference in the conformal dimensions, and this is the critical exponent with which my charge distribution changes as I go along the line. And I put in some s zero here because essentially, I have to choose some point on my geodesic relative to which I am quoting this expression. This is not surprising because, remember, every time we, every one of these expressions is always quoted relative to some cutoff. So I'm going to quote some cutoff. This cutoff is going to choose some S0 which lives on that geodesic. And then starting from that zero point, I will have a suppression or an exponential growth of the charge along the geodesic. I didn't explain it to you in detail here right now, because doing it in more detail would require me, first of all, to be more careful in writing down my notes, and second of all, it's kind of tedious, but it's in the paper that I wrote, so I advise you to consult it. But anyway, this is the thing that you have to insert if you have fields that you're starting with that have different conformal dimensions. So in fact, let me just multiply this over here and erase this condition, and this is the actual answer. Yes.
Sorry, you said that S0 is tied to some specific regularization description?
Yeah, just like the normalization of a... So notice what happens when I change S0? I'm just going to multiply this by a constant. So that's like the normalization for an operator in the CFT. You gave me an operator and I said, oh, now I'm going to dilate it by some amount. So this multiplies it by some delta. So same thing here. Previously I had a point and I dilated it, so the point stayed fixed but everything around it grew. Now I have a geodesic and I'm again dilating it. Dilating along the geodesic means that I'm actually moving along the geodesic a little bit, and that motion is the choice of that as zero. Yeah. And I have a feeling that I messed something up here, because when I divide this, the product of these two things by that, I don't actually get one in the case of equal conformal dimensions. It seems like I would have, if I had a two divided by two, then I would have the right thing. So I'm sorry, I'm just pointing out that I messed something up here, but think about where the factor of two should be. There's some factor of two that's missing. Either I should have a two here, or a division by two over there. I don't have a division by two over there, so I have to have a two here. Is that what it is? Okay, so sorry about that. Work it out if you're interested. But that's the argument in words. Okay, so good. So we have limited our. So we have now concluded that our OPE blocks, we know what they are in the CFT, and we know what they are in ABS, which is nice. So now let's start addressing those question marks that we have on the board. And if we do that, then we will be done with that subject. So the first. The first one over here is this question mark. You see, I needed to go through this argument to tell you that we actually just care about geodesics and not about tubes, because the moment we're talking about geodesics, then I can pull out of a hat a formula that which erases that top question mark over there. So the statement is this. What we have is ABS space and some field which lives in ABS space. And what we're doing is going to kinematic space. But any point in kinematic space is actually an integral of this field along a geodesic, possibly with some exponential suppression factor. So it turns out we can give this guy a name. Of course, we already have a name for it. It's just the OP block. So I could just write here B delta X of Y. But just for the purposes of this argument, let me call it phi tilde of X comma Y. And the reason why I introduced this notation is that it's fairly standard. This object here is called the X-ray transform. And I wrote here attenuated because of this extra exponential suppression. If I don't have an exponential suppression, if the two external operator dimensions are equal, if I don't have this, then I won't have the word extenuated. It will attenuated. It will just be the X-ray transform. A generalization of this is called the Radon transform, which we will also have something to say about. So a Radon transform is like the X-ray transform, where I don't integrate along geodesics, but along some higher, possibly along higher dimensional surfaces. And an X-ray transform is just a special case where my surfaces are one-dimensional. So I have this, and the statement is that if I have an object which lives in my space, and I have some object which lives in the space of geodesics, which is defined in this fashion, if they are X-ray transforms, if one is an X-ray transform of the other, then the wave equation in ADS is equivalent to the wave equation in kinematic space with the opposite sign. And so, in fact, there is a theorem which says that those two things imply one another. So I don't know if you guys want to hear a proof of the theorem. Is it worth talking about or not? But it's just a fact that that's true. So maybe I should just sketch the proof a little bit. So I'm going to, oh, this is a nice board, and this one's, I'm going to erase this one. Which is to
go to
act with the opposite conformal transformation on my geodesic gamma. So if I have some geodesic, if I had my point and I moved it in some way according to some conformal symmetry, I'll take the same conformal symmetry and move back a geodesic that passed through it, yes? So that's my G inverse. If I have a G inverse acting on it, yes, then that means that the expression for that G in terms of the conformal generators is going to be the same one as before, except I have a minus of omega AB. Do you agree with me? That's mm-hmm. what the opposite conformal symmetry is doing, yes? And the statement is that those two things have to cancel each other out. So if I act with G on the point, and if I act with G inverse on the geodesic, then those two expressions, these two actions are equivalent, cancel each other out, yes? So that means that I think the statement that I want to write is that LAB acting on phi of y must be equal to minus LAB acting on phi tilde of y of gamma, except that this expression makes no sense because this lives in the space of geodesics and this lives in the space of points. So what do I mean by that? I mean that if I acted with the opposite transformation on a geodesic, then acting on the point has the, okay, if I acted with some conformal symmetry on a point, then I can undo it by acting with the opposite transformation on geodesic. But to say that this is the opposite action, to really make that statement, I have to translate both statements to the same space. This guy is in the space of geodesics, so what I have to do is take this translated point and form its x-ray transform, and the statement is that this guy will be equal to that thing. So I'm going to put a big tilde over here, and that big tilde is the statement that I want. So let me read again in words what this is saying. It's saying that if I have a given point, and I translate that point according to some conformal symmetry, and I take the x-ray transform of that translated field, which is what this big tilde is doing, and that's equivalent to starting with the already x-rayed field and then just acting with the opposite conformal symmetry. So that's what this equation is doing. So this relation here is called intertwinement. In general, intertwining relations are the relations that I can, if I have some transform from one field to another field, then I can, and I have an operator, I can act with an operator before doing the transform. Yes? And then you ask, is there some other operator which will perform the same job, equivalent job after the transform? And that equivalent job performing the operator after the transform is this guy. This is the one performing it before the transform. I act with the operator, take the transform, or equivalently, I take first the transform and then do the act with an operator. And the statement is that those two operators are actually the same elements of conformal symmetry, except for that extra minus sign. So now that I have this equation, I realize that these boxes here are just quadratic expressions in this LABs. So that means that LAB squared and summed over the indices AB is going to give me the same thing as that. So the two equations should be absolutely the same. You should protest now. So there is a minus sign here, but that minus sign will drop out after I take a quadratic form to form the box. So you can say, why do I have a plus sign here? But in fact, that's just a convention. And the convention has to do with which way we picked the space-like and the time-like coordinates in kinematic space. I told you that the space-like coordinates were going to be the location coordinates or the center point coordinates, whereas the time-like coordinates were going to be the separation or the size coordinates. If I had made the opposite choice, I would have a minus sign here. So that's just a convention-dependent fact. Okay. So anyway, that's a sketch of the proof of this formula. Any questions about that? Okay, so I have successfully erased this question mark, because that's what's established on these boards. What remains is these question marks, and I see that I have a few minutes before 6 o'clock, If the idea was to finish by 5 and leave the rest of the time for questions, then I'm doing miserably badly at it. But so let's just say a few words about these other question marks. It's going to be pretty quick. So the first thing I want to say is for B equals 2, so ADS3 CFT2 correspondence. In that case, remember that our kinematic space, yes, was actually, I mean, first of all, it was this. But then we remember that this, just like all of conformal symmetry in two dimensions, decomposes into left movers and right movers. Similarly, I could use that decomposition over here and write it as follows. So in fact, okay, and this corresponded to my kinematic space having this form. Okay. So I've been talking about the Casimir of the conformal group, but in fact, in this case, my kinematic space decomposes into a product of two different quotient groups, and each of them has its own Casimir. So there is something we would call L squared, and there is something we would call L squared, L bar squared, which lives in the other, which acts in the other, the sitter component of this geometry. And what I've been talking about is the full Casimir of the full conformal group. So what I previously called L squared, and I'm sorry for the stupid notation, it was really the sum of these two things, okay? That's what I previously called L squared, it was the sum of these two things. But they in fact have two different independent Casimirs. So I can also call, I can also form an independent, an anti-symmetric combination of these two L squares. So I can write L squared minus L bar squared, and this thing will also be a Casimir of this group. And so this other Casimir, this gives me a second equation of motion, and that second equation of motion is precisely the one that I needed to fill in this part of the table. Does that make sense? Now, you might say, is there some intuitive way of thinking about why this extra equation of motion had to be there? Remember, this is exactly what we needed because our D equals 2 kinematic space had two time directions. So this is the second one. And the fact that I have two time directions, well, there is one of them, there is the other one of them. Each of them has an independent Casimir, which gives rise to an independent wave equation, so we're okay. Was there some way of intuiting that I would get this other equation, like yet another way of seeing it? And the yet another way is to think about the X-ray transform again. So the X-ray transform lives in kinematic space. So this is equivalent to a point over here, or a piece of data that lives over there. This guy here is considered as a function of ADS space, lives in three dimensions. Whereas this guy depends on a geodesic, and geodesics live in a four-dimensional space, yes? So if I take some field configuration and take its X-ray transform, I'm mapping a function of three coordinates to a function of four coordinates. Of course, the image of that map is never going to be surjective. I'm not going to cover the whole space. So there will be one equation which will define what, or which will select what the image of the X-ray transform is. This other equation is precisely that second equation of motion that I have over here. So there are two ways in which I can fill this question mark, or replace this question mark over here. One is that it's the second Casimir, and another one is to say that this is the image of the X-ray transform, which is the image of tilde. And they are equivalent statements. So now, but that only works for D equals 2, so when I'm only missing one equation of motion. So what about I shouldn't have said this. It's the second Casimir from the viewpoint of kinematic space. It is the image of the X-ray transform from the ADS point of view. Yeah. That's what these things are. So from the ADS point of view, I know that X-raying some field is going to produce an image which satisfies an equation. From the kinematic space point of view, I'm just using conformal symmetry to say what it is, and it's the extra Casimir that I have. So I filled in both question marks that I had over here. Now, you might say, that's special to D equals 2. So what do I do in other dimensions? And depending on what you're interested in, you might find my answer exciting, which is that we don't exactly know what to do here. We do know that in higher dimensional cases, we need more than just one. We need D minus one extra equations. And we know that these extra D minus one equations are related to, they all should relate to this equation if I put if I consider my geodesic to be part of a particular ADS-free subspace. So let me just explain this a little more. If I have a general dimensional ADS space, then this is like in higher dimensions, then a slice of it which looks like this will be ADS-free. And you can ask, and on every one of these ADS-3s, an equation, an argument that I just made would work. So what you can do is you can take your d-dimensional conformal symmetry and think of all the extra quantum numbers, all the extra spin quantum numbers that you have, as just extra labels of fields. So forget about it being being spatial coordinates. And try to do a dimensional reduction on all the directions which are orthogonal to a particular ADS-free subspace. And in that ADS-free subspace, this argument would work, and you would get one equation. So somehow, these extra d minus one equations should be related to the question, in how many independent ways can I embed ADS-3 in a higher dimensional ADS space? And if the answer is d minus one ways, then that's good. Notice that that's what works. That's how it works for ADS-3 itself. In how many ways can I embed ADS-3 inside ADS-3? In one way. And that one way is the way that produced that equation. So hopefully, there is one independent way of hopefully there are two independent ways of embedding ADS-3 inside ADS-4. The crux is in the word independent. What do we mean by independent? So that's the thing that's not clear. So there is a discussion of this point in a paper by Myers, De Boer, Hell, and Helen, to which I have occasionally referred to before. And so in there, they have a section where they discuss what this means. And in general, there are many more ways of embedding ADS-3 in a higher dimensional ADS space. But most of those different ways, when you translate them into algebraic equations of the time that you have there, are identically zero. So you're not learning any new information. So what we're looking for is an independent set, and independent in an operator sense. So not just algebraically independent, as in not just linear relations between generators which translate one ADS-3 into another ADS-3 subspace, but operator relations between those generators. And they have a discussion where they reduce the number of such things to some quadratic in D, but we know that the answer should be D minus one. And then they say, we conjecture that there should be a further, and they do that using just linear relations between generators of conformal group, between these LABs. And they say, we conjecture that that this quadratic number of relations can be further reduced to D minus one of them, which are correct as operator equations, but they're not algebraic. So they're not linear combinations of generators, but they are some quadratic and higher relations. I can't tell you anything more about this. That's the state of the art as far as what we know. So if someone here is interested in like formal properties of the conformal group, then this is really an easy question for a well-equipped mathematician to understand how this number of equations will reduce. Notice that in essence, what I'm describing is a sort of kinematic space of four points, because we're talking about how ADS-3 can be embedded inside ADS-D plus one. Yes? Now, kinematic space was the space of pairs of points. But if I add one more point in the future and one more point in the past and make it four points, then now I will have selected an ADS-3 subspace. So every ADS-3 subspace of ADS space is like a point in a kinematic space of quadruples of points, as opposed to pairs of points. And somehow understanding that is going to tell you why there are d minus 1 and not some other number of equations. So, all right, that's all I have to say for now. And if some of what I said was confusing, it's partly because it's my fault, but partly because these things are just not known. So I'm telling you about what things are current research or open problems. All right, thank you very much. And what will we talk about tomorrow? So tomorrow I'll tell you about, maybe we'll make it a little shorter than today. So tomorrow I will tell you about application. So one thing you could ask about this is, it seems like what I talked about today is very disconnected from the entanglement from yesterday, which is from the entanglement entropy. So I'll tell you about one way, at least one way in which those two stories connect. And also, and in general, tell you about a few more applications of kinematic space, so things that were difficult but now become easy using this language. And maybe I'll tell you about what I'm working on right now, but it depends on what I prepare and if we have enough time. But at least I'll tell you about applications of this.
Mm-hmm. Tomorrow at 4?
Tomorrow at 4.
Okay.
Thank you.